celebrating 10 years of great radio, over 500 episodes, and over 500 hours of radio content. Thank you.
Wow, those are some great questions.
I did my homework on you, obviously, and watched some previous...
Yeah, you sound like you did.
Great. Now, Bruce, that was such a good interview. I've done so many of these now, that was easily one of the best.
Great interview, Bruce. Thank you so much.
This was an awesome interview. Thank you so much.
You know, the ability, I've discovered in all the shows that I do and stuff, the ability to pack a lot of information in as an organization and, you know, making up questions and stuff in advance.
Yeah.
And you're one of the few people who's ever done that. I wish more radio people would do it. A lot of them just wing it.
You actually read the book.
Thanks, Bruce. I really appreciate it. Yes, really great questions. I really appreciate that.
Bruce, it's been a pleasure. I really enjoyed this talking with you.
That's a good question. And actually, I'm really glad you bring that up.
You know, I don't know. That's a good question.
Listen, Bruce, you know, a lot of very probing and thoughtful questions from you. I don't expect that I'm going to be asked some of these questions, but very, very intense stuff. And, you know, you garnered some very intense answers.
The Baron of Broadcasting. The new theater of the mind. The Bruce Collins Show.
Welcome back to the Bruce Collins Show. We're very glad to have you join us. Tonight, we're going to be talking to Professor Gary Habermas. Professor Gary Habermas is legendary for debates he's had on the historicity of Jesus' death and resurrection, as well as the existence of God. He's the author of The Case for the Resurrection of Jesus. If you've ever had doubts about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, listen to this interview with Professor Gary Habermas this hour. The Bruce Collins Show airs every Thursday night at 10 p.m. right here at WWPR, 1490 a.m. You can also listen to us streaming on Friday nights at 10 p.m. Eastern Time at ipbn-fm.com. That's ipbn-fm.com. We have a Facebook page for The Bruce Collins Show. Go to Facebook, search for The Bruce Collins Show, and like us there. And you can email the show at bruce_collins_show@aol.com. Guess what? The Bruce Collins Show also has a YouTube channel. Visit YouTube, search for the Bruce Collins Show channel, subscribe, and catch all the latest shows on YouTube. And now, let's get right to it. Action-packed hour, full of a lot of important information. Professor Gary Habermas talks about his book, The Case for the Resurrection of Jesus, in a moment. Joining us this week is Professor Gary Habermas. Gary Habermas has dedicated his professional life to the examination of the relevant historical, philosophical, and theological issues surrounding the death and resurrection of Jesus. His extensive list of publications and debates provides a thorough account of the current state of the issue. Gary is the author of many books, including The Case for the Resurrection of Jesus and The Historical Jesus, Ancient Evidence for the Life of Christ. Gary's website is GaryHabermas.com. Let me spell his last name. It's H-A-B-E-R-M-A-S, GaryHabermas.com. Gary Habermas, welcome to the Bruce Collins Show.
Well, Bruce, I'm glad to be with you. It's always good to talk about this topic, and of course, we are at the appropriate time of the year to be talking about it, so that's good on two counts.
That's right. Now, before we talk about the evidence surrounding the resurrection of Jesus Christ, can you tell us how this became a big focal point for your research?
Sure. Well, the start of it was rather selfish. I was raised in a Christian home, but I started going through some really heavy doubts. In fact, and I mean, this isn't a secret. I've told it many times, and it's even published. But I almost wandered away from Christianity, and that's another story in itself. But I had just very deep questions, and so my friends would come alongside me, and they'd say, "Well, have you considered this evidence? Have you considered that evidence? What about this? What do you think about that?" And of course, they would say things that a lot of Christians would be familiar with. They'd say, "Well, look at the argument for creation, or look at the arguments for God's existence, or what about archaeology, or what about evidence from the Old or New Testaments, the Dead Sea Scrolls, other findings that the Bible's reliable." And some of these I would study, and I just outright rejected. I mean, some of the things they told me were just kind of silly. Like they would say, "Well, have you heard that they found a secret Josephus?" Well, that was many years ago when I studied this stuff. There's no secret Josephus. And then they'd say, "Well, do you know about the Acts of Pilate?" Well, there's a report about the Acts of Pilate in the ancient world, but no book that would correspond to that. So some of them I just rejected outright, but some of them made a little bit of sense, and none of them made a lot of sense. I mean, the kind where I could bank my faith on it, maybe faith in this aspect or that aspect, but not at all of Christianity. One day I was reading, and I was just happened to be flipping around a portion on the resurrection, and the author said something like, "If Jesus was raised from the dead, this would speak truthfully regarding his teachings, and we could know what he said was true and that his way of salvation was accurate based on the fact that he's raised from the dead." Well, I looked at the argument itself without looking at evidence, just at the way the argument would work. And I asked myself, does it follow that if this and that and this, you know, were true about the resurrection, would it follow that Christianity would come along too? And I became convinced, way before I was convinced that the resurrection made sense, that if the resurrection did do those things, it would be a good argument for Christianity, certainly better than anything I'd ever seen. So, as they say, that got me going, and that was the first blow, and the final blow hasn't come yet, so I'm not off the subject yet. But I've been on the subject ever since, and it's moved from my questions to other people's questions to speaking to debating to books to whatever.
Mm-hmm. And I had thought about asking you, why is this important for believers and non-believers alike, but really it's equally important because without the resurrection, there is no hope of salvation, is there?
Well, yeah, now that's Paul's argument in 1 Corinthians 15, and at least there's no Christian hope of salvation. I mean, you know, you can go somewhere else and hope somebody else has it right, some other religion. But I mean, Paul says if Christ hasn't been raised twice, different Greek word, by the way, but same meaning. He says if Christ had not been raised, our faith is vain. And the Greek word for vain is empty, fruitless, without foundation. But then he goes on and says in verse 18, 1 Corinthians 15, 18, he said if Christ had not been raised, that our loved ones who have died in Christ have died in vain. And then just previously he says our sins haven't been forgiven. So the real bad news is that if Christ hasn't been raised, we can't be saved because there's no, you know, bridge between here and there. But also, I mean, this was long before my wife died, but my wife died of cancer in 1995, four children, all at home, the youngest only 9 years old. And verse 18 was especially poignant to me. You know, if Christ had not been raised, then our loved ones who died in Christ have died in vain. And I thought, well, you know, I mean, I never doubted at that point. Strangely enough, my doubts never came back when my wife died, and I'm so thankful for that. But you know, I did think to myself, you know, from Paul's viewpoint, it'd be okay if Buddhism's true, but Jesus isn't. I mean, yeah. Christianity isn't if Jesus hasn't been raised. So, yeah, I mean, there's not just the resurrection. There's the Christian worldview. If you think of circles, the resurrection would be part of the gospel, which is always defined in Scripture as the God side of the gospel, is the deity, death, resurrection of Jesus. And then there's the human side, which is the I do side, the saying I do to Jesus for commitment. Then the larger circle is the Christian worldview, so we have to, you know, go to, is Christianity true? But then we still ask this practical question, which you just did right off the bat, and it's a good way to characterize that. If it's true, what about it? Well, it's things like our preaching's not in vain, our sins have been forgiven, our loved ones who died in Christ have not died in vain. So, yeah, I mean, the long and the short of it is it all depends on the resurrection.
Mm-hmm. Now, some of our listeners might be surprised to learn that there were non-Christian sources who wrote about the death of Jesus Christ by crucifixion. Can you tell us about that?
Well, sure. In my book, Historical Jesus, you mentioned it already. And by the way, this chapter on secular sources is on my website, free of charge, GaryHabermas.com. But I go for about 150 years after the death of Jesus, which is pretty fair in the ancient world when you're doing ancient history. And now a few of them I let go a little later than that if they had earlier sources, if they were based on earlier texts. But for the most part, I came up with about a dozen and a half sources for Jesus. And the interesting thing is that exactly two-thirds, 12 out of 18, mentioned Jesus' death. His death is the most mentioned aspect in the secular sources. They don't all say the same thing, but they'll say he died, or they'll say one source calls him a crucified sophist, you know, a crucified philosopher. It's said that he was killed by the Romans. And we have some verses about the early church and so on and so on. But a number of sources from reasonably early tell us most frequently about Jesus' death. But they also record supernatural things about Jesus, like they list names, you know, deity, names of deity that he was called and that people said. One of them, Pliny, a Roman governor, said that Christian, he was actually persecuting them and killing them, but he was saying they would gather together, Christians would gather together before dawn on a special day of the week, and they would sing hymns to Jesus as unto a God. So that's a pretty interesting reference there, but we can learn, for those who want to learn things that are not repeated in any Christian source, you know, we've got those. I think I come up with a list in that chapter of 50 or 60 items that we can learn about Jesus and the earliest church without ever opening up the New Testament or a Christian work.
Hmm. Now, there are figures in history inside of Scripture and also outside of Scripture, you know, the Bible, who claimed and believed in the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. Can you touch on some of these figures?
Yeah, we have that. Now, for the most part, they're either Christian authors outside the New Testament. I'm not talking about any New Testament sources. Mm-hmm. Outside the New Testament. By the way, we have some very early sources. If we date the New Testament, the close of the New Testament, to about 100 A.D., we have one source, Clement of Rome, not to be confused with Clement of Alexandria, but Clement of Rome, he wrote actually before the New Testament canon was even completed. He wrote about 95 A.D. We have two other guys, Ignatius, who wrote seven short epistles on the way to martyrdom. He wrote about 107 A.D., only about 7 years later. And Polycarp, who also was martyred later, and he wrote about 110 A.D. He wrote an epistle to Philippians. So those are seven Christian sources from very, very early. But if you mean non-Christian sources, we have, well, Josephus mentions the risen Jesus, and there's a dispute about was his passage touched up by Christian writers later. But a lot of the middle road is what's taken by most scholars, and I think that Josephus very well could have said that, but been saying more like Christians teach that he was raised from the dead, not that Josephus himself believed it. We also have some Gnostic sources, which were declared heretical later, so they're not Christian sources, but they report the resurrection. So there are a number of those. And then you know what, too? You have to throw in some really interesting arguments, like what do we do with the Shroud of Turin? Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't think the Shroud has to be the burial ground of Jesus, but there's some pretty decent arguments that what was wrapped around Jesus, and that the image on the Shroud, the image of the dead crucified body, was put there by radiation from a dead body. The arguments are pretty persuasive. I don't say they do the deal. I'll take historical arguments for the resurrection over the Shroud any day. But the Shroud is intriguing, and obviously the Shroud isn't a Christian or non-Christian source. It's an archaeological source, but it would also help us talk. There's a few other archaeological things that help us with Jesus, too.
And it's also compelling, as your book points out, the case for the resurrection of Jesus, that inside of Scripture, that the disciples obviously believed in the fact that Jesus rose from the dead, didn't they?
Oh, well, I mean, they not only believed it, because if they didn't, you can't explain why they turned the world upside down.
Right.
I mean, you know, when there are religious wars today and suicide bombings, or when missionaries of more than one religion are killed by people from other religions. I mean, I think of the Buddhist priests who set themselves on fire to protest the war in Vietnam. When people do something like that, it's generally allowed that whether you agree with them or you don't agree with them, it's allowed that they believe it, that they wouldn't die for a lie. And the Buddhists believe the war in Vietnam was wrong. Simple as that. Critics allow that the disciples thought Jesus was raised to the dead. In fact, I often say it this way, and I watch my words very carefully here. Virtually no critical scholar. Now, the key is scholar. I don't care how critical they are. They can be an agnostic. They can be some species of skeptic. They could be an atheist. They could be, you know, about anything. Mm-hmm. And they will grant, if they're a scholar, by that I mean they've been trained in the field, they know the subject, they know where the evidence is, and they're not just going off, they're not just angry. They will agree to this sentence. I'd say 95 percentile are going to agree to this sentence. And the sentence is, the disciples had experiences that they believed were appearances of the risen Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
The disciples had experiences which they believed were appearances of the risen Jesus. Real experiences and really believed. That's conceded by everybody who studies the material.
Mm-hmm. And talk about Paul. Why is Paul in particular an important person in determining the authenticity of the resurrection of Jesus Christ?
Well, that's a great question. Here's one of the biggest misnomers that people don't understand. If I'm starting to do this, and I'm on a university campus, I've got to go to a university in just 2 weeks, Lord willing, and speak at a huge secular university. And oftentimes I'll say to them, I'm only going to use material that critical scholars will allow, even if they're atheistic New Testament scholars. And then I'll say, let's think about 1 Corinthians 15. And right away somebody will say, there you go. You're doing a bait and switch on us. You say you're going to talk about this like a skeptic, and then you pull 1 Corinthians out of a hat. What do you think we are, stupid? All right, well, what they're showing right off the bat is that they're not a New Testament scholar, or they haven't done New Testament backgrounds. And the reason I say that is you can get a scholar no matter how far to the left they are, but as long as they're a scholar that has studied New Testament or a cognate field, and ask them which books of Paul are authoritative. Now, Paul's the critical darling, in a way, because they believe he's in the right space, right place, right time, and has the knowledge to write, important things. Now, you go, well, all right, what do you mean by right place, right time, right etc. And here's what I mean. Of the 13 books that have Paul's name on them in the New Testament, critics, I mean, let me just use the name. People can say, well, you always say critics. Tell us somebody. Well, Bart Ehrman, who's probably the best-known New Testament critic in North America, Ph.D. New Testament, Princeton Seminary, and Bart Ehrman describes himself as an agnostic leaning toward atheism, pretty skeptical.
Yeah.
And Bart Ehrman, in his introduction to the New Testament, and he's typical of everybody, but he's just so well-known, I use him, he talks about the quote-unquote undisputed Pauline epistles. And the undisputed Pauline epistles number at least seven of the 13, and these are the seven they'll give you. They always give you the same ones. Romans, 1st, 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Philippians, 1st Thessalonians, and Philemon. Now, they give you those seven books, and now some Christians get upset and say, no, I'm not talking to you unless you give me all 13. No, I'm going to go from the other end. I'm going to say, well, look, I think all 13 are authoritative, but you're going to give me these seven? Yeah, I'll take them. I'll take it and run. I'll take the seven you give me. Now, what do they mean by authoritative? Critics think, here's some of the arguments for them liking Paul. They know who the author is, for starters. They knew who the author is. Secondly, he studied well. The tradition is that he studied under Gamaliel. People like to talk about who they did their PhD under or whatever. Paul did his PhD, so to speak, under the top scholar in Israel. Mentioned in the book of Acts, by the way. But he was a Pharisee, which puts him in one of the best-known theological camps of the time. And he knew the eyewitnesses. He knew the apostles. And in Galatians 1, that Bart Ehrman says is a very respectable argument, he goes to Jerusalem just 3 years after his conversion and spends 15 days with Peter and James, the brother of Jesus. And they discuss the nature of the gospel. 14 years, he goes back, and he sees Peter and James again, and this time John's there. Now, the significance of this is that these are the four most influential Christians in the early church, and Paul knew the other three, besides himself. So, to roll it all into a single sentence, Paul is, they know who the author is, he's a scholar, according to the Jews, who opposed their message, he studied under the right guy, he knew the other apostles, he knew the times, he knew the, seasons and society and right place, right time kind of guy. So that's what they mean by authoritative. They're not going to tell you, oh yeah, those seven books are inspired. No critic says that. They don't use the word inspired. But they'll say they're all authoritative. In other words, Paul could say something and be wrong, but they'll almost never say Paul was wrong. They'll just say, yeah, at the very least, from his perspective, that was true, So they don't think he would lie. That's another thing. So for all those reasons, yeah, Paul says that in one of those seven books, you're good to go. And when I give an argument for the resurrection, like at a secular campus, I love to use 1 Corinthians 15 and Galatians, the end of Galatians 1, beginning of Galatians 2, which was a single passage in the originals. There's no chapter dividing there. Mm-hmm. And so Paul, that's a good text. And Bart Ehrman, again, this very well-known skeptic, Bart Ehrman thinks he's got a whole chapter devoted to two arguments that are good arguments for the historical Jesus, he says, and that's one of them. That's one of his two arguments, that Paul knew these guys and went there and interviewed them, and so that's an impressive argument for the historicity of Jesus.
And James, you mentioned James, because he was a skeptic, he's pretty compelling in providing a piece of this puzzle, isn't he?
He is, because critics have different rules for why they use verses in the New Testament. And as I tell my students, critics who don't know New Testament scholarship, they don't know their own people. They don't know their own critical scholars. And if you don't use New Testament verses with these guys, they will use them. They won't hesitate to go to the New Testament. Here's the difference. Critics will only cite verses that are authoritative for certain reasons. And when you say, well, okay, I know why the ones in Paul's seven epistles are. How about the occasional verse that you pull from the Gospels or from one of the other epistles? Why do you use those? Well, because there's other reasons that say these are true. And you go, well, like what? What reasons? Well, New Testament scholars will use the same rules historians use. Like if an historian does a study on, oh, take an ancient author who may have been a little bit of a distance away from the events he records, let's say a war, and they're looking for signs that he knows what he's talking about. They will use certain tools to explain and evidence a text. Well, when it comes to James, a couple of these rules are apparent. And so skeptics will virtually always allow that James was a skeptic and did not believe his brother was the Messiah. Now, two of those rules is, number one, multiple attestation. That's the so-called two heads are better than one rule, because there's two independent sources that say that James was an unbeliever. And like Paul Meyer, who's retired professor of ancient history at Western Michigan University, as Paul Meyer says, many things in the ancient world turn on just one source. And two sources make a lot of the ancient world's events unarguable. I mean, they're just true if you've got two sources. And we have two independent sources for James being an unbeliever. And by the way, James, Josephus tells us about him being a leader of the early church. Josephus wasn't even a believer. There's a Jewish historian. So we've got some good data on James. So number one, multiple sources. And number two, embarrassment. If usually we have to have a really good excuse to tell a really, really embarrassing story about somebody. I don't mean, you know, you go to a dinner and your wife asks you later when you're going home, why did you say that, made me look bad. I don't mean some little thing that you let slip out and so on and so on. I mean when you are talking and it's a central teaching, a central point, and she's really placed in a bad light. And when the kind of thing where everybody else present would go, whoa, I don't know why he said that. Something like that. Well, it's very embarrassing that when these books were written, when the epistles were written, and later the Gospels, well, James may not have been around by then. He was martyred pretty early in the early 60s. But the texts say that James was an unbeliever. And then all of a sudden, he's the pastor of the church in Jerusalem. Now, why are you saying that the church in Jerusalem is pastored by a guy who knew his brother very, very well, who was in a very good position to know if what was reported was true or false, and he saw his brother, and he maintained that what his brother said was false? Now, that's not the kind of thing you probably want to spread around about the pastor of a few thousand people in Jerusalem. So we have this really embarrassing testimony, and we have multiple sources about James, even a secular source for Josephus about his martyrdom. So, that's pretty impressive evidence, and critics will virtually never question James's unbelief before he met the risen Jesus.
That's very compelling. Now, some of your research focuses on the empty tomb. Can you talk about the importance of the empty tomb?
Yeah, for the empty tomb, let's start with this. The empty tomb is a part of the resurrection story, and it's a good evidence for the resurrection. However, if all we had was the empty tomb, we wouldn't have said Jesus was raised. I mean, there was a case years ago, and Lee Strobel starts his one of his chapters in The Case for Christ by telling this story. I think it's a chapter in the empty tomb, where they got permission to move a little girl's grave. I think she was killed during the race riots in the 60s. And they got permission to exhume her body, and when they dug down there and got the casket, there was nobody in it. It was an empty casket. And as Lee Strobel says, nobody said, oh my goodness, she's been raised from the dead. What they said was, what is this? They keep playing tricks on us, and we didn't even get the little girl buried properly. Where is she? Where's her body? That's what they're going to say. And so, normally speaking, you wouldn't, you wouldn't just say empty tomb means all of a sudden you're raised automatically, you'd say, yeah, what about body snatchers? The interesting thing is that the New Testament itself has two different theories on where the body could have gone. And one is they report that the Roman soldiers were paid to lie and say the disciples came and took the body. But the other story, Mary Magdalene, thinks that the gardener took the body. So, I mean, those views had to be dispelled. They had to be disproven. But my point is, those are the things that come to people's mind, even to Christians like Mary Magdalene. So, okay, so the first thing is an empty tomb doesn't prove a resurrection, but an empty tomb is one of the pegs on the way to the argument if you have other pegs to go with it. Now, having said that, I gave a paper late last year at a professional conference where the title was that I had over 20 arguments for the empty tomb. Now, the amazing thing about 20 arguments is that there are so many, they're very early, and critics agree with most of them. So this case for the empty tomb is pretty sizable, and, you know, we can talk about some of those if you want. But, you know, it wouldn't take long to get some of the best evidence for the empty tomb, but there's a lot of people who think that the empty tomb is quite heavily evidenced. The majority of scholars today, from what I can tell from reading the sources, about two-thirds of scholars writing today in the area will admit the empty tomb. When I went to graduate school, by the way, in the 70s, if you admitted the empty tomb, they would pretty much know you're either an evangelical or a conservative Catholic, because they were like the only ones walking around saying the tomb was empty.
You know, let's talk about this, because I've noticed in recent years especially, a lot of people are saying, Bill Maher had a movie where he was trying to say that the story of Jesus was the story of Horus, I believe. And some critics look at other figures in other religions, and they try to say that the resurrection of Jesus was simply a parallel to another myth. What does your research find about these things?
Well, there's a lot of things to say there, but let me just start. This doesn't prove it wrong, but it will make you wonder what we've missed when we say that. Mm-hmm. There are almost no New Testament scholars today, I don't care how liberal you are, almost none of them will say there's any basis for the view that Christians copied the empty tomb or resurrection message from pagans. In fact, there's books by two skeptics. Both of these scholars call themselves agnostics. Both of them call themselves unbelievers. They're both New Testament scholars. One is the aforementioned Bart Ehrman, an American, and one, a fellow who just passed away recently, but he was a very well-known historical Jesus scholar. His name is Morris Casey. Both of them, being unbelievers and agnostics, wrote books against those who say Jesus never lived. And the view you're talking about, did the Christians copy from pagan religions? That view is quite common among the Jesus never lived people. And they both go off on that view. Both Morris Casey and Bart Ehrman go off on that theory. Now you wonder, why would they do that? I mean, if they're looking for an alternative theory, why don't they take that? Because they think the evidence is bad. And the sources they list as the best sources in the field to disprove this, one of them is by a University of Chicago scholar. I mean, you know, Chicago's like Harvard or Yale. A University of Chicago scholar who wrote a famous an essay. He's been at Chicago for a long time, and he wrote a famous essay everybody else quotes from. His name is Smith. And there's another Smith, actually. Two of the best refutations of this theory are two scholars named Smith, but one of them is at Chicago. And they say it's not true. Now, just the fact that they say it's not true doesn't mean it isn't true. But the next thing you have to do is see why they think it's not. One of the best reasons is there's no clear evidence that these non-Christian sources are pre-Christian. Our earliest sources for a resurrected pagan god, and it's nothing like, when I say resurrected, it's nothing like the resurrection of Jesus. Mm-hmm. The stories are just, they're wild. I mean, they're like Hansel and Gretel type stories. They're nothing like, and somebody will say, well, that's what the New Testament is. But not if you talk about evidence, not if you talk about data. And the earliest one is the mythical god Adonis. Never lived. And actually, Adonis is the second earliest one. And the stories that talk about his experience, and again, he never lived, is 3rd century A.D. 3rd century A.D. And the only earlier ones are from the 2nd century A.D. So they're post-Christian.
Yeah.
Now, some people say, well, we got some evidence that, you know, in carvings and things like that, that show that that's probably a resurrection. But, you know, without words, it's really hard to tell what these carvings are. There was one account in recent years where somebody found a carving in a cave, and they said, this looks like Jonah, the story of Jonah and the whale. And later, the explanation had nothing to do with that. So, because they know from this, they know from other stories like this what this one was. But what I'm saying is, how do you tell from a picture, you know, what the real secret is here?
Yeah.
So, Adonis and Attis are the two earliest ones, and Adonis is 2nd century A.D., and Attis is 3rd, I may have mixed that up, but Adonis is 2nd century A.D., Attis is 3rd century A.D. They're the earliest manuscripts we have. So, I mean, if anything, they could have copied up Christianity. I'm not saying they did, but it's kind of hard to prove we copied up somebody when you don't have the source there. And just believe me, I could talk about details if you want, but there is virtually no similarity whatsoever between what the New Testament tells and what these pagan stories say.
Yeah. Now, what about getting back to the empty tomb? I wanted to ask you about the suggestion that the disciples stole the body, which, I mean, it wouldn't make sense, because why did they then go to their deaths believing that he was resurrected? But what about that suggestion? Can you talk about that?
Sure. Now, I always start, I mean, not always, but I generally start by telling where scholars are in this. And people mistakenly think that I'm arguing that it's wrong because the scholars say it's wrong. And I'm not saying that. My point is, if even the skeptics who are not Christians say it's wrong, then there must be reasons the skeptics say it's wrong. That's my point. And that view has basically not been held since the late 1700s. So, you know, we're almost 250 years from the last time that has been seriously taught. Now, if you're a skeptic and you're looking for a good theory and you won't use that one, why not? You want a theory. You don't want to believe the resurrection. You want Christians to be made fun of. Why don't you say that? Because when you do, as Bart Ehrman says, when Christians are sitting there waiting for you to argue with them, he says they want you to come up with a naturalistic theory. They want you to come up with a natural theory. And as Bart Ehrman implies, he says coming up with a false theory for a Christian is like throwing raw meat to a dog. They love it. Well, the reason Christians love it is because they have such good comebacks. Now, in that particular theory, you're right. Let's go back to the Buddhist priests who committed suicide, burned themselves to death, which is a horrible death. But they did that to protest the war in Vietnam. And I think we'd all agree, man, they really objected to that war. Okay, well, that's fair. You don't burn yourself to death, you know, being silly, unless it was an accident. But if you mean to do it, you must believe what you're saying. That's the point. Well, why would you leave your businesses, be it tax collecting, which is pretty lucrative, fishing, which is a good middle-class income, why would you give some of these things up? Why would you walk away for at least periods of time? Why would you walk away from your family and go on the road and continually come back and live like a pauper? And the big thing is, why would you put up with so many episodes of persecution?
Mm-hmm.
and people coming after you. And I tell my students, my theory isn't going to rest on that they actually died. We can show that in a number of important cases, but all I say is they were willing to die for their message. They were willing to die. And if they're doing all that, if you ask me, name one scholar who thinks the disciples were lying, they stole the body and lied. Bruce, I cannot name a single critic who would say they died and were lying mm-hmm. about their message.
Yeah.
That's how bad it is.
Yeah.
And forget about them being willing to die and also giving their whole life for it. You can't even explain their transformation. I mean, when they got up in the morning, I'm just talking this way, but here's how I picture it. I picture them jumping up in the morning and can't wait to get to it the next day. They weren't depressed. They weren't having issues. They happily preached the message. Sure, people could say, well, there are people in all kinds of religions who are excited and preach. That's true. But the disciples are the only ones who willingly died because the center of their message was that they had experiences that they thought were resurrection appearances of Jesus. In other words, they were the only ones who knew whether or not they really saw the risen Jesus. And they were willing to die for the fact that they did. Now, that's the argument. Not that nobody, you can find a lot of examples in other religions. Of course you can't. The Buddhist priests opposed the war in Vietnam. Absolutely. And they should, that's an honorable death. But so is giving your life for a Christian message, and they would hardly have done it had they stole the body. I mean, the argument makes no sense. It's so bad that critics don't come up with a response for, what did I say, 250 years.
Yeah. Now, in your book, The Case for the Resurrection of Jesus, and I know you've also debated this, you make a point that when Jesus appeared after the resurrection, he was in bodily form. And I've always thought that based on the Bible, but some people believe it was a heavenly vision. Can you explain this?
Well, let's go back to my grad days. There were several things that if I had told you where scholarship was when I was in grad school at Michigan State in the 1970s, if I said I believed in an empty tomb, they'd say, yeah, you're pretty conservative. There are a lot of things like that, and this is one of them. If I said, Jesus not just appeared, but he appeared bodily. Now, strangely enough, it was kind of an in view to say that Jesus appeared. I mean, they were okay with that. But they generally thought, because the resurrection has always been a fairly popular view, the evidence is good. Mm-hmm. But it was often a view that says Jesus was this light figure, an image of light, like a hologram. And he was really there. He was really there. He could really talk. You know, if you're familiar with Plato, they would say, oh, it's all in Plato. That, when we die, we flee from our bodies and we live in a spiritual existence in the heavens, learning knowledge and being with other people. I mean, that's basically Plato. Well, they would say, yeah, that's Jesus too. And Jesus was not bodily. There's still a sense that the body is, sinful. It's not good, but God made us with bodies. And they would have let me say that in the 70s. I could have said Jesus was raised, but not bodily. But when I say bodily, now someone starts rolling their eyes in the 70s. Today, it is arguably, this would be a close call, but it is arguably the most popular view today that, at the very least, that the disciples thought that Jesus was raised bodily.
Yeah.
At least that's what they taught.
Yeah.
Even Paul, one writer, William Lane Craig, who's well known to some of your listeners, probably mm-hmm. Bill Craig.
Mm-hmm.
Bill actually says in one of his books, he thinks the case for Paul seeing a bodily resurrection is clearer than the case that the Gospels are teaching a bodily resurrection, which everybody pretty much thinks is a given. Because, he asked for food in Luke, he makes a shore lunch in John, etc. But even Paul. And that's where scholarship pretty much is today. It certainly is respectable to say that Paul and Peter and so on believed in bodily resurrection. That's That's respectable today. It wasn't very respectable in the 70s.
I saw you in a debate with Anthony Flew, and John Ankerberg was actually moderating it. And he said that he thought it was sort of like a vision or a hallucination. And you make a great point that if it's a hallucination, how would all of the disciples have seen it together?
Right. Yeah, Tony and I were very good friends, and he's there's no need to be nasty to people when you're talking to them. And Tony and I were really good friends for I'd say 25 years, and he died in 2010. But that was our second of three debates, and he did hold that view. But the problem is, in the earliest, most critically accepted passage, critics love 1 Corinthians 15, verses 3 to 7. It's a long story, but they believe that this goes back, that passage was actually constructed, and the testimonies in it, the list of the appearances was actually pre-Pauline, predates Paul's conversion. And in the six appearances that are given, one, Paul seems to just tack his name onto the end, last of all, he appeared to me. Of the other five, three of them are group appearances, one to the group called the 12, one to a group called all the apostles, and one to 500 at one time. And those groups make hallucination pretty tough. Mm-hmm. In fact, in our first dialogue together in it was a debate at Liberty University in 1985, Anthony Flew even says, after he and I kind of went to it nicely, but we had this dialogue back and forth, I said, well, what do you do with the group appearances? Because he allowed the text in 1 Corinthians 15, like almost everybody does, and he was an atheist. There's another example. And he actually says in the text, he says, well, I've always understood that group hallucinations are impossible. And I thought to myself, well, there you have it. So, I mean, he even said that. So it's a tough one. It's a tough one. If I understand Bart Ehrman's view correctly, the skeptic we referred to earlier, he used to be pro-hallucination. Now he says he's not going to pick a naturalistic theory. So I think I'm just guessing, but it sounds like he's had his own afterthoughts.
Interesting. Now, we're ending up at the end of the hour. So before we go, if someone wants to purchase your books, is there a certain book that you would suggest they start with first? And also, and they can buy them on Kindle, because actually I bought some of your books on Kindle recently.
Okay.
Is there a certain book, though, that they should start with first? And also, tell our listeners what they can find at your website, GaryHabermas.com. And again, that's Gary, H-A-B-E-R-M-A-S, GaryHabermas.com.
Right. I appreciate that last comment, because I don't sell anything on my website. There's a whole lot of material there, resurrection, dealing with doubt. Some of my publications are there, lectures, debates. They're on my website. So they can, probably the thing that might be most helpful, if not the subject of doubt, most materials are on the resurrection. Now, as far as a book, I think I would recommend the two books, actually, that you've been mentioning. I think the first one I would send them to is The Case for the Resurrection, written by myself and Mike Licona. L-I-C-O-N-A. Myself and Mike Licona. Kriegel is the publisher. And that's written as kind of an introductory level. Now, there's 100 pages almost of notes there that people can get into a little bit deeper if they want to, but they don't have to read the end notes. But I'd say that's a pretty good introductory. And for other questions, like what they know about Jesus outside the New Testament, some of the things you've asked, the book The Historical Jesus, published by College Press. Historical Jesus. So I'd say those two.
Great. And again, we've been speaking with Gary Habermas this week. You can find out more information at GaryHabermas.com and check out his books on Amazon, Gary Habermas. Now, Gary, this has been great. It's been a real honor and a real treat for me, and I would love to have you back in about 3 or 4 months, and we could talk about some different things. And I know you've done research, for instance, on near-death experiences.
Right. By the way, there's a lot of near-death experiences on my website, too.
Great.
Evidential ones, where people can find some reasons to believe that something's really going on with some of those, the cases where people say they were conscious of what was going on around them after they were pronounced with no measurable heart or brain activity. So those are pretty, you know, they don't, that doesn't distinguish the world religions.
Yeah.
Because, you know, a Muslim or a Jew or a Hindu could say amen, but it would distinguish naturalism, that says that the natural world is all there is, there's no supernatural. That would be Hindus would be a real tough one for naturalism. And since they're the big boys in the block in terms of influence today, that's an important evidence against them.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, Gary Habermas at GaryHabermas.com. Gary, I hope I can have you back sometime.
Sure. Be glad to come back with you, Bruce. Not a problem.
Great. Hello there. This is Bruce Collins, the host of The Bruce Collins Show. When I'm not hosting my show, I'm making public service announcements like this one. Just kidding. I did, however, want to thank you for listening to The Bruce Collins Show. There are many programs you can listen to, but you, my friend, have the ability to discriminate between The Bruce Collins Show and everything else. Of course, we never ask for a donation on this program, and even if you were to try to send us one, we would turn you down. I'll be frank, God provides the funds for this program through my employment during the day. That said, I am by no means wealthy in the business sense, but I'm doing fine. There's one thing you can do, however. Support Christian charities that clothe and feed the homeless and meet the needs of the poor. You can do that as a token of your thanks for listening to the show, if you are able to do so. Thank you for listening, and thank you for your dedication to making this world a better place. We strive to provide you with great entertainment, and as always, we hope you enjoy the program. Thank you. Thank you once again for joining us here on The Bruce Collins Show, where we broadcast every Thursday night at 10 p.m. right here at WWPR, 1490 a.m. Remember, God loves you. We do too. Don't give up.